exploration is exciting. It's stimulating. Hopefully you're going to get to do something. You can fly an airplane, do whatever the thing is out there. The simulation industry has really rallied to you and for you by taking all their time and effort to put this out. We need you, but you need an industry that's strong and that's growing. There's something like 27,000 people in jobs right now in the simulation industry here. Average salary is about $70,000. Average salary is about $70,000 for start, and that's not bad. If we can double that, the reach of it, of billions of dollars going into the economy, we can double the amount in the Florida economy and the jobs. We can have a job market right here where you can go to a place, look at it, see what's there, apply for a job. So it's really exciting. And when you talk about simulation itself, you know, why is it so important? Well, it's just common sense. It's not illegal. Common sense is not illegal. When you look at what we're doing, just take driving. Take flying. General will come up here and tell a little bit about flying, but he learned a lot. Probably 80% of his time was done on the ground learning how to do it. So think of the money that's saved in that. It really is an incredible opportunity. We're going to need not only your help on that today, but we're going to need your continuing help and involvement. You are part of the millennial generation. You're 45 million nationally. You are the single biggest voting bloc in the country. Baby boomers are second at 40 million. So in your hands, and those of you registered, you're going to have a great deal to say about who the next president is going to be. And as frustrating as it may sound, that's just really right around the corner. We have the opportunity at this point. What we're going to do is, as you maybe know or something, there's an incredible important vote going on up in the Congress. It's probably, in my opinion, one of the most, so far it is the most important vote of the year. And as we talk, there's just hours left, and the question is the government going to be shut down, which is going to have incredible economic impact. It's one of the dumbest things. No, it's not one of the dumbest. It is the dumbest thing that I've seen in my years. So put me down as neutral on that issue, if you would. And it's really a sad event. We have Senator Bill Nelson. I had dinner with him a couple nights ago. He had any idea when the vote was going to be going back and forth and that. And, of course, John Mica. And the House is supposed to caucus and vote at about 10 o'clock today. And the Senate is supposed to do something a little bit later. And the hopes are is they'll take what's called a continuing resolution, which just extends the debt and pass that and then go work on it. I don't know if that's going to happen or not. We're getting down to not just the hours, but practically the minute. So, you know, we're sitting here, little piece of history. I mean, we're really sitting here as part of this because we're going to hear from Congressman Mike and Senator Nelson and that. And it's we're looking under the chart a little bit and look what's going on. And we have someone who's here who will be voting, who in a few hours, it's an incredible part of history that we have a chance to look to.
Good morning. I wish I could be there with you, but as you know, we've got a lot of brinksmanship that is going on in Washington, and we're expecting several major votes here today, and so I've got to be in Washington. I wish I could be with you because I want to be celebrating with you a world-renowned hub of modeling and simulation technology. And it's right here in Central Florida, and it's one of the nation's hubs, and it's in our hometown. I want to thank you and start with a quick note to all of the students here today. Long ago, but it's worth noting, that Lou Frey not only has brought this institute to UCF, but back in the 1970s when he was congressman, the Navy considered moving their training device center over at the Naval Training Center, which today is Baldwin Park. Well, they were going to send it to another city. It was going to replace a naval ship research and development laboratory in another city, which was then scheduled to move to Washington. But Congressman Frey didn't want that to happen. He was determined to keep the center and the jobs that came with it at the Naval Training Center in Orlando. And he did. And after personal appeals, telephone calls, old-fashioned lobbying, Congressman Frey accomplished his goal, and the Navy announced that they would keep the Training Device Center in Orlando. So thanks to Congressman Frey's hard work and dedication, it remained in Orlando. I had the privilege of following Congressman Frey in the Congress. And again, there was what was called the Naval Training Equipment Center. And it was going to be shifted, but a new institution called the Central Florida Research Park was started. And so what folks said is, why don't we get this Naval Training Equipment Center, which is going to move out of what was then the Naval Training Center, and let's put it in Central Florida's Research Park. And so I happened to be congressman at the time. I lobbied the chief of naval operations, the top four-star admiral. As a matter of fact, it got down to the very last day when he was changing command, and he had on his desk the letter stating that the Naval Training Equipment Center would move to the Central Florida new research park. That was the last letter he signed as he walked out to the ceremony to turn over the Chief of Naval Operations over to an incoming admiral. And the rest is history. And now we have all of the services that are there involved, and what has now turned into a simulation center for America. Simulation plays an integral role in the training not only of our U.S. military forces, but in so much of what we've done. The Army uses the facility. They have a major command there. The Air Force led the way by using simulated training for takeoffs and landing, as well as high-risk and emergency situations. Other services followed suit. The Army and the Marine Corps are increasingly relying on simulated training to give soldiers a feel for what might happen in various ground situations, such as a vehicle rollover or a vehicle evacuation. Simulated training is an extremely valuable tool that can help get our U.S. forces ready for multiple situations. And that's why in this coming fiscal year, as a matter of fact, that starts Tuesday, October the 1st, the National Defense Authorization Act, I supported the continuing partnership that we have between government-owned and commercial simulation support. Now, unfortunately, this is part of the crisis that we're facing in Washington. Congress has failed to put aside the political differences, the ideological rigidity, and to find common sense solutions to our nation's most pressing financial woes. And this kind of ideological rigidity is what's got us wound around the axle in Washington right now. Now, I want to tell you a little bit about that, but I first want you to know that what has been done in simulation in the military has now expanded so much into the commercial industry as well. And that's where Orlando, the Central Florida Research Park, the University of Central Florida has become one of the simulation hubs in the entire country. And that is, there's a huge technological triangle in East Central Florida, anchored in the west by the Central Florida Research Park, anchored the next part of the triangle to the northeast at the Kennedy Space Center and all of that activity, and to the south in the Melbourne area with Harris, with Northrop Grumman, with DRS, and so forth. But here we are around, wound around the axle in Washington, and the sequester is an example. It was never intended. The sequester is a meat cleaver. It's across the board. If you're going to cut spending, what you've got to do it in a way that is intelligent, not in this meat cleaver approach across the board, both defense and non-defense. Sequestration was never intended to go into effect. It was the force, the meat cleaver, the guillotine hanging over the head of the super committee in order to get them 2 years ago to make the tough decisions for deficit reduction. But, of course, they deadlocked, and that is what we're dealing with now, to try to get rid of the sequester, just to fund the government on Tuesday, as well as then to face on or about October the 17th the shutdown of everything, because the government has to be able to pay its bills by raising the artificial debt ceiling so the government can continue to borrow to pay its bills. Thus, that's where we are, and the solutions are obvious. We need more targeted budget cuts of wasteful government spending, coupled with realistic tax reform, getting rid of a lot of the special loopholes that will bring in additional revenue that we can actually lower tax rates and at the same time produce additional revenue for the growth of what our people need. So here we are. And now this is all getting balled up in the fight over the new health care law, which takes effect in the expansion of the health care markets tomorrow on October the 1st. So it is my hope that we are going to avert these disasters, that we're going to get people to come together in a bipartisan way, avoid the economic consequences where the country's credit would be downgraded, where individual stock market portfolios would be savaged, put aside the partisan political differences in favor of finding common sense solutions. We can't afford this kind of lack of will to work together. And that's what the American people want. They want us to work together. That's what I'm dedicated to, and I thank you for the privilege that you give me of public service, even though we are now in some trying times. Thank you. God bless you, and God bless our country.
Well, thank you to Senator Nelson. I have just been told that the senator is calling in this morning and would like to join us via telephone conference. Good morning, Senator Nelson. Are you with us?
Good morning, Lou.
Senator, thank you for calling in this morning. This is Bill Diamond. I just had the pleasure of introducing you, and we just watched the video message that you recorded to the 400 bright-eyed and eager students this morning who have been listening to you. So thank you for your message this morning, and thank you for the important work that you are engaged in this morning up there in Washington, D.C. We know you're very busy, and we appreciate you calling in.
Well, it's my pleasure, and I just wish that I could be with you. This is brinksmanship in government, and government should be conducted in this way. However, it is what it is. I want to tell you all that the subject that you come together on is an extremely important one for many, many reasons, not least of which is that simulation, taking advantage of the new technologies that allow us to basically simulate real-life conditions, whatever it is, things of in medical field, for example, using simulated cadavers in training medical students. Clearly, the obvious one is simulating the conditions in a cockpit. In addition to everything that's going on out at UCF and the Central Florida Research Park, for example, simulators have become standard fare now in the training of pilots. I've had the occasion to go out to what they call JetBlue University out at the Orlando Airport. It's its own facility that they bring in all of their crews to go through the simulators. I recently did in a big cargo airline the simulator for the largest cargo airliner, the 747-800. And they can do conditions that simulate the real-life conditions that are so good that in the training of our military pilots, for example, over north of Milton, Florida, what is called Whiting Field, which is a part of the training of naval aviators at Pensacola, the instructors tell me that the simulators are so good that the student pilots can go out and get in an airplane and fly the airplane for the first time without flaws because the simulators have adequately prepared them before they ever get in the aircraft itself to do their first solo flight. And so, too, what we have right in Central Florida, and I told you in the video how instrumental Lou Frey was in setting up and preserving that part at the Naval Training Center, which is where I used to live, now Baldwin Park, how he kept that alive. And then when I came along, they wanted to start the Central Florida Research Park back as a part of the university. The university, by the way, back then was not called UCF. It was Florida Technological University. And the first anchor tenant was a part of the Naval Training Center, a component called the Naval Training Equipment Center. And it ended up being first anchor tenant to start what is today the Central Florida Research Park, which is one of the major concentrations of the simulation industry in the entire world. And so we've seen this simulation industry in Central Florida grow by leaps and bounds. And, of course, what it does for our economy is obvious. And what it does is also obvious in playing an absolutely important part in the training of not only our U.S. military forces, but as well the offshoots into the commercial industry. Now, the Navy became the anchor tenant, and then the Air Force became a major component in simulated training for takeoffs in landings, as well as what to do in emergency situations. And then the Army, the Marine Corps, increasingly rely on simulated training to give their soldiers a feel what might happen in ground situations. Many Central Florida industries, for example, that produce weapon systems, simultaneously they produce simulators to help train the various users of those systems in order to have them and to be able to get ready to use them actually in the field. And so even though we have fights on the defense bills, there's always somebody pulling and tugging, such as the big Air Force base in Dayton, Ohio. They have a lot of simulation training. There's always the pulls and the tugs to try to take the simulation industry away from Orlando and pull it to someplace else. But we've been able to prevent that, and I don't believe that you're going to see anybody successful, as evidence, for example, in the 2014 defense authorization bill, where we have the continuing partnership between the government-owned and the commercial simulation. It makes sense, by the way, for not only the government but commercial users, because you can train your people so much more effectively and economically by utilizing simulators. And in this era of less, not more, in the way of government appropriations, that becomes a critical component of having a highly trained, skilled workforce, particularly in the U.S. Defense industry. I'm sorry that you all have to witness what's going on in Washington, and in the video that I did for you, I already talked a little bit about this. And I will just leave it there. Suffice it to say that by midnight tonight, we will know whether or not there's going to be a shutdown. If there is, I think it will be a short-lived one. It would have enormous consequences because, for example, about 95% of all the NASA employees, that's the civil servants of NASA, about 95% of them would be laid off. And, of course, for however long this goes, then we have to worry about getting the back pay, because these folks, it's no fault of their own, they should be able to rely on a steady paycheck so they can feed their families. And so that would be another harangue that we would go through. All of this is coming uncomfortably close to the reckoning day of now estimated to be October the 17th, which is the point at which the United States government cannot shuffle its accounts around anymore, but would have to go out and float more U.S. Treasury bills in order to borrow the money to fund the government to pay its bills. That's therefore raising an artificial, in statute, not in the Constitution, in statute, debt ceiling beyond which the government cannot borrow anymore unless you raise that number in the debt ceiling. And although people have played around with this politically in years past, it's never come to the point of being really serious to get to the point that the government actually goes into defaults and cannot pay its obligations. Hopefully that will not be the case this October the 17th. And it's my hope that cooler heads will prevail. And I think that's what you're seeing now, is that cooler heads are beginning to prevail, not only on the one at midnight tonight, which is no more appropriations, because there's not an appropriations bill to fund the government services, but also the one that comes in a couple of weeks, the government being able to fund its obligations. So with that, Bill, if you'd like to ask any questions, if Lou is there and he wants to ask any questions, I'll be happy to entertain them. And you all have a great, great conference.
Thank you, Senator Nelson.
I wish that I could be there with you today.
Well, we certainly appreciate you taking time to call in this morning, and we know that you will play a role in the cooler heads prevailing, and we wish you the best of luck up there. We thank you for your service to our country and to the citizens of Florida, and we would be remiss if we did not wish you happy birthday, as I understand yesterday was your birthday. So why don't we all wish the Senator happy birthday?
Hello, this is Congressman John Mica. And I'm sorry I can't be with you in person, but wanted to send along this message. First of all, congratulations to the Institute for Government and Politics at the University of Central Florida. I want to thank Lou Frey and the Institute for this opportunity to participate. I'd hope to be there in person, but again, we have crossroads that's almost historic with the funding of government coming due in a few days. We've got the problem of mounting federal deficit. And then on top of that, we have the implementation of Obamacare almost simultaneously. So that keeps me in Washington and also at the helm of responsibility under the Constitution for representing the people of the 7th Congressional District. But I welcome everyone to UCF and to the Lou Frey Institute. And particularly on this symposium that's so important on simulation and modeling. In Central Florida, we are really fortunate to have the National Center, which is headed by Tom Baptiste. I know he's on the schedule, and you'll hear from him. He's one of the foremost experts, not only in America, but in the world on simulation and modeling. And we're honored to have him and the National Center again, just right next door to UCF. Thank President Hitt for again sponsoring with UCF, a great university, this symposium and the Institute. I've been involved in simulation almost all my time in Congress. In fact, when we first got started some 20 years ago with involvement, we knew that Florida couldn't exist just on the three legs of tourism, construction, and agriculture. We knew we had to broaden our base, and while we only had a couple of the services located in Central Florida at the Research Park, we wanted to expand that base, and we've been very successful over the years, and a combination of members of Congress and community leaders, and also the leadership of the National Center for Simulation, all came together and brought not only the military, but also the commercial aspects of simulation to Central Florida. Now, again, it's important that I be here in Washington exercising that constitutional responsibility, because there wouldn't be any simulation activity in Central Florida if we don't fund the government. So first of all, we have that responsibility. And funding just for the next CR or for the next fiscal year is important, but funding long-term, not only for the government, but also for simulation is important. I've been a strong advocate of simulation, first of all, because I'm a fiscal conservative. I'm basically a tightwad, if most of you know me, and particularly with my money and taxpayers' money. And nothing has a better return than simulation. And when you have a military that is downsizing, We've had a strong campaign led by Tom Baptiste, by economic development folks, Rick Wheadle, and other folks from the community, leaders coming up, and simulation industry folks, all here in Washington to send the message that simulation is something we shouldn't be cutting. We should actually be increasing, because we can, again, in a time of fiscal austerity, we can train our troops. We can have a whole host of applications of simulation modeling that's actually save us money, and then also prepare us and give us readiness. I've been pleased to work with some of my colleagues in Congress, not only the local delegation, but some of the leaders who also believe that simulation is important. Now, one of the things that we've got to do in Central Florida, and you're going to focus on the opportunities, and I think I looked at the program, it's a great program. You start first with education, and that's so important. The STEM program, getting qualified students, there will be jobs, and there are jobs in the future if people have the training and our young people have the education. So supporting that, and your discussion today will be very good around that topic, but it is important. We have qualified individuals coming out of our schools and our colleges. University of Central Florida has led the way with the advanced degrees, and again, all they have done for advancing simulation and modeling. So I think that's very important, but again, long term, we've got to make certain that this budget of Congress and appropriations measures, and that's one of the things we're going to try to do is pass an individual bill. If we pass any kinds of extensions or CR, it'll just be till December, and that gives us a time to actually complete a bill, because we don't want the bad effects of sequestration to carry over into the new fiscal year. So that's something we're working on here. Great response, great coordination working at the local level here in Washington with folks, and we'll continue that effort. So as you discuss some of the topics in front of us today in this symposium, you'll have to take into consideration the funding issue. Long term, we need to look at more applications, more commercialization, and bringing the industry together, and then also trying to keep this in Central Florida. It's to our advantage. And there's also a great advantage to the United States of America, the military, and others, to make certain that we brought and keep all together, that we continue to keep all together, all the activities we have. You can't duplicate what we have in Central Florida anyplace else for the future. So that's got to be our goal. So I wish you well. I wish I could be there with you in person. I'll be there with you in spirit. But again, making certain that simulation continues for and all elements that are so important of our government activities continue in a responsible fashion. But again, I salute the Lou Frey Institute. Thank University of Central Florida and its leadership, Tom Baptiste, all those who've been involved in simulation. This is Congressman John Mica, looking forward to working with you as we work together to make certain that simulation continues to provide an important economic activity and activity for readiness in our military and so many other applications. Thank you so much. Bye now.
And I understand that Congressman Mica has called in this morning as well, so we're going to get to hear from both of our federal legislators this morning.
I am just a couple of feet off of the House floor. We are going to go in session in about 2 minutes, and the House will officially open. I'm in the Republican cloakroom just off the floor. Been here most of the weekend looking for my senators, but they haven't shown up. But I'm pleased to be with you. I am pleased also to have down there representing me, Patrick Kelly, a UCF graduate. Raise your hand, Patrick. Show them where you are.
Patrick's in the back of the room.
Now, there's hope for the rest of you who haven't graduated, but there's hope for the rest of you knights who haven't graduated. My chief of staff, who started out as an intern Riley Deck is a UCF graduate. My special projects director, who's been working with me already this morning, my right-hand person in Washington, Kevin Stone, is a UCF graduate. I, as a Gator, am totally outnumbered by these UCFers, but I am pleased to be with you. In the background, you might have heard the bells just go off. The House is going into session right now. We do have a difficult day. We've had a difficult weekend. The Knights with South Carolina had a difficult weekend too. But what you do is you dust yourself off and you go to work and you. You do your job. Many of the students that are there, I'm not going to give a political speech, but maybe a motivational speech. You're now focused on finishing your academic career, and then you want to get a J-O-B that pays you M-O-N-E-Y. So I can't think of a better area to be in than high-tech, simulation, modeling. We have the Center for Optics with laser activities. I was down there a few weeks ago, got a great tour of some of the activities that we don't even think about. We have technology to pursue, and I think incredible opportunities. And that's where you all got to be. You got to be on the cutting edge. You can't be left behind. So I look forward. I had the opportunity to represent UCF in my first 10 years. Then it was taken away with redistricting back in. I'm very excited about it. We started some of the programs that have flourished or helped start. No one does anything by themselves, you find, in life. But I look forward to working with you all. I invite the students, anyone who wants to intern, we'd love to have you. We try to fit everybody in who is wayward enough to get into politics to join us in some capacity, either in the district or in Washington. And then career-wise, if we can help, and also expanding some of the programs with UCF. But we want our university to be on the cutting edge of getting you all the best opportunities for the future. So I think you heard in my video my commitment to simulation industry, and you have to work with everybody to do that. I work with Senator Nelson and the rest of the delegation. We're in a tough time right now because so much hinges on the government funding. As you're watching the news, I'm an eternal optimist. Somehow we'll work it out tonight and in the future. I love to read history, too, and if some of you meander by the library and pick up some of the history books, you'll find what I've found, that it hasn't changed much, that it's always meant to have this this conflict, this open discussion, and then the democratic process of moving forward. We do it, and the good Lord looks out for us, and we get it done and succeed as a country. So I'm anxious to, again, help you any way I can in the university, working with Dr. Kitt. Lou Frey does a great job with the Institute, and pleased to work with him. I'm sorry I couldn't be there in person, but pleased to be on the phone this morning a couple minutes. Not sure how my day is going to end up. I will say one of the more productive things I got done this weekend was my laundry, which was piling up here. Well, some of you students know how that goes. You wait till you can't find anything else. Well, I can't describe it this morning before coffee. So.
Congressman, thank you so much. We hope your day ends well, because that may signal whether our day ends well, all of us here in the country. We appreciate your time this morning. We know you are busy. We know you have been a tremendous advocate for the modeling and simulation industry and the presence that that we benefit from here in Central Florida. We are a little behind schedule, and in an effort to get back on schedule, we will thank you. And let's give Congressman Micah a warm round of applause.
Thank you.
singing, little runaway, I was blind. Yeah, running down a dream that never would come to me. Working on a mystery, going wherever it leads. Running down a dream. I felt so pure, like anything was possible. Hit cruise control and rub my eyes. The last 3 days, the rain was unstoppable. It was always cold, no sunshine.
Anybody out there would like to be a fighter pilot? Come on. Bill, sorry. Okay, I need somebody over here. Raise your hand again. Okay, volunteer in the blue shirt. Unless you're 6'4", and then you're not a volunteer. Stand up. Stand up. How tall are you? 11. Stand up next to him. There you go. You're elected. Come on forward. Thanks for volunteering. Well, let me tell you what it takes to be a fighter pilot. And that was your United States Air Force Thunderbirds that you just saw in that video. About 45 years ago, I sat in a room not nearly as grand as this, much smaller, in a little Northern California high school with about 400 kids, trying to figure out exactly what I thought I might be able to do once I left high school and what the future might look like. I had this really strong desire to fly, but I'd never flown an airplane by myself. I'd ridden an airliner, I'd ridden in a small Cessna, but I thought, you know, maybe there's an opportunity there. But let me tell you what it takes first. You have to be an officer in the United States Air Force or any one of our military services in order to be a pilot, which means you have to go to college. The degree is not negotiable. You also have to have perfect eyesight, you have to be physically fit, you have to pass a very stringent flight physical in order to get into the program. If you pass all those hurdles, you have a number of options on how it is that you would become be accepted into flight school. You have to be a commissioned officer. So you can go to one of the academies, you can pursue a commission through a reserve officer training course at any colleges, a number of colleges across the U.S., or you can go to officer training school, which I did, which required me to have a degree and then apply for and be accepted to go. Now, once you get past that hoop, and oh, by the way, you'd be a leg up if during your college you pursued a science, technology, engineering, and mathematics degree. But if you pass all those hoops, then what you have to do is you have to go through a flight screening program in the Cessna 172. You got to safely solo and take off and land that airplane before they'll allow you to go to jet training. You go to your pilot training base and you get to fly two jets, the T-37 and the T-38. This is the Air Force model. And if you are considered to be the right stuff, then you get on a fighter track and you get to fly the T-38, which is a supersonic jet trainer. And that will get you on the track that ends up in being assigned to a fighter aircraft. Now, what happened after I did that? Well, I spent 34 years flying fighters, the F-4 Phantom and then the F-16. I moved 22 times. I spent 15 years overseas, as far west as Okinawa and Korea, as far north as Canada, as far east as Italy, Germany, and Belgium, in and out of Afghanistan and Iraq on a number of occasions. I'd recommend you pass on those last two. But I enjoyed myself 100%, and I'm young enough now to run a corporation and do some more things to advance the state of the art of simulation, be a passionate advocate and an evangelist for what goes on here. That's just part of the uniform right there. You would have to put on a harness. You'd have to put on an anti-G garment so that you don't black out when you pull a lot of Gs. It keeps the blood in your head, which is a good thing when you're flying. You don't want it to be down in your belly. So the anti-G garment helps you do that. So that's what it would take to become a fighter pilot. What if you don't have good eyes? How about being part of the team that builds the next fighter? Builds the fighter that follows the F-35, which is currently in production, and will replace the F-16. What would that take? Pretty much the same sort of things I outlined, minus the flying piece. Pursue a STEM education. Stay in school. Go to college. Pursue a science, technology, engineering, or mathematics degree. And then find your way into this simulation industry that's right here in your backyard. One of the keys of what we're doing today is to bring you together and let you see some things that maybe you haven't been able to see before. But to tell you about an industry and an opportunity after graduation from college right here in Central Florida. You heard the jobs numbers, you saw the figures on the video that when you were first walking in on how big this industry is. It's a big deal. It's a big deal, and it's a big opportunity for the right people who do the right things to prepare themselves to become part of it. And as you saw in the video and you heard from Senator Nelson and Congressman Nemaika, this industry is starting to expand well beyond its primary target, which is the Department of Defense and our military forces, into many other exciting areas such as medical simulation, in education and transportation, in homeland security. The way we train our first responders to a natural disaster can benefit from simulation. Digital media, serious games, and entertainment are all the synergy between classic simulation and the games that you play are so powerful now that the military recognizes that they can leverage the power of a game engine to develop immersive kinds of simulation and training where you can place the trainee into an environment that looks just like it will look when they get off the airplane in Afghanistan or Iraq. And they can do that training in the virtual world. In an area that doesn't require 10,000 acres of range space, they can do it in a room much smaller than this. Train an individual soldier, train groups of soldiers, all in an immersive environment. So, what are you going to do today? Hopefully, you're going to stop hearing a lot of people talking, and you're going to need to go see some things. But you're going to have to wait until after lunch. But what you are going to see is the program has been designed to give you just a taste of the many things we've talked about, not just DOD and the military, but other things like medical and education and other things where simulation is starting to become super, super important as well as very, very powerful. So whether you want to fly the next fighter or whether you want to build it, the path is similar. It's all about education. It's all about the right education. And there are opportunities out there. So my message is stay in school. Pursue a STEM education. Join the simulation industry right here in your backyard in Central Florida. We need to grow the workforce of the future today, and that workforce is you. Enjoy the rest of your day.
The U.S. military organizations in Orlando, Army, Navy, Marines, and Air Force, are at the core of a simulation and training industry that contributes over $4.8 billion to Florida's gross state product. Close to 30,000 high-tech jobs with salaries averaging $70,000 a year directly support the industry. When combined with indirect and induced jobs, the industry employs over 60,000. The military presence is critical if Orlando is to maintain and grow this industry. Some Central Floridians believe our uniformed military services left the area when the Orlando Training Center closed its doors during the base realignment and closure in the mid-90s. The story of Orlando's military simulation and training components, what they do, how they do it, and how it impacts Central Florida is fascinating but not frequently told. It all began with a partnership that was documented by the signatures of the secretaries of the U.S. Army and Navy on March 20, 1950. By direction, the services were to collaborate in the area of training and training devices. At that time, their offices were located in Long Island, New York, but in 1965, they moved to Central Florida, and for almost 50 years, they have called Orlando home. They first located on the Naval Training Center, then in the mid-80s made the move to the new Central Florida Research Park, where state and local leaders envisioned a high-tech growth sector and set the conditions for success. As the other military services joined the Army and Navy, and UCF established the Institute for Simulation and Training, they soon realized the government, academia, and industry partnership was headed for greatness. As a team, they encourage collaboration, teamwork, and leveraging technologies and programs. They became Team Orlando. The supporting industry base began to flourish too. First, the invention of laser weapons training provided soldiers with immediate feedback when firing their weapons during training and more accurate scoring. And the 90s delivered large-scale operations with tanks, planes, and large-scale military exercises, and the use of personal computers and video games as new ways to train. Central Florida's modeling and simulation industry had indeed achieved world recognition. In 2007, the U.S. Congress declared modeling and simulation a critical technology. By using simulation, the military had better training, which was less expensive and environmentally sound. Team Orlando became known as the Center of Excellence for Modeling and Simulation. And most importantly, the training devices and simulations from Central Florida were and continue to be directly responsible for training the men and women of our military, and through that training, contribute to the safe return of deployed troops. But military training was just the beginning. The spin-offs to complementary industries is ever increasing and include education, transportation, homeland security, digital media, entertainment, and serious games with strong connections to Orlando's new creative village, and medical and healthcare training with ties to Lake Nona's Medical City. Today, through a UCF Institute for Simulation and Training digital puppetry program, new teachers can train in a virtual classroom and interact with role players portrayed in the simulation as students with challenges that the new teacher may face before they enter a real classroom. Surgeons can practice before they make their first cut. Emergency managers can practice response scenarios through simulation to ensure they are prepared for the real crisis. All this because almost 50 years ago, the Army and Navy training commands made their way from New York to Orlando and set in motion a multi-billion-dollar industry. Yes, the simulation industry has been good for Central Florida, but what if tomorrow it were gone? The 2012 President's budget calls for two rounds of base realignment and closure. Because of the growth, the military complex that houses the employees in Central Florida Research Park is bursting at the seams. The space required by the military long ago exceeded the office space in the complex. Throughout the years, the state of Florida has done an excellent job in providing funds to house the overflow and continue to promote the military, academia, and industry partnership through shared space with the university. Because of the simulation industry's continued growth, available infrastructure, and the services now rely on approximately 200,000 square feet of leased office space. Not only is this a financial burden, with rented office space costing nearly $5 million annually, the very fact that the military is in leased space makes elements of Team Orlando vulnerable for realignment or movement to available federally owned office space. And Florida stands to lose the dynamic high-tech growth industry we call the modeling and simulation capital of the world. For now, the Metro Orlando community is executing a strategic BRAC mitigation plan aimed at protecting, growing, and enhancing the modeling and simulation industry cluster in Central Florida. We can only imagine what the future holds as new technologies and simulation solutions evolve. As a community, we can use the same magic of teamwork and partnership that made Central Florida's simulation industry great to ensure it remains home to the industry.